Hi, my name is Erin Renier, and I'm the professor of cello here at Washburn University. Today, I'm here to help you get through these wonderful audition excerpts for KMEA. We're first going to start off with the stinker of all of them, and that's the Beethoven Minuetto. Beethoven wrote these great symphonies, and one of the things that he did is like to give the cellos and basses a hard time. With the amount of a typical symphonic orchestra, you're looking at the size of about 20 to 25 cellists in a section. So Beethoven was thinking in that concept when he was putting this one together and wanting to really make the sound minimal, but as a whole in the section, it would come off big in terms of dynamic. So what we want to make sure of when we're doing this excerpt is not to overplay. Make sure that you are keeping it very minimal in terms of sound and length of bow, because it's a virtual marathon in terms of jumping to different strings and also making sure that your arm doesn't get too tired as you play. It just really is, it's a difficult one. The other thing it's a challenge is the tempo. We have it set at a quarter equals 104, and the issue with that is that you don't want to feel like you have to play that speed. As long as you're representing the speed, you know, quarter equals 96, even quarter note equals 100, you're very close. Don't sacrifice intonation, articulation, dynamics for the sake of speed. It's not worth it. So really make sure that you keep low energy in terms of that. All right, so first thing I want to talk about is probably the gnarly bits of the piece. If you look at measures 11, 13, 15, and 16, they're a bit of a challenge because you have to stretch to accomplish the octave of the Cs. Most people don't have large hands. I, for one, do not. So what I've done is I've written in the music the most simplistic version of fingerings that we can come up with. If you look there at 11, I'll show you the example what I would do. Basically, we're starting in first position, open 3, open 4, 1, 4, shift to fourth position on the D string. Keep your thumb nice and loose so that way you can transfer smoothly between the two. So 4, 1, 4, 1, 4, 1, then across to get back. So that's between measures 11 and 12. In 13, I have you go to third position, open 2 on the E flat, open G, 1 on the C, 4 on the E flat, across to 1 on the G on the D string, then up to 4th. And then we do that similar octave shift. Then in 14, I'm going to have you go over to the C string and play a 2 in 4th position, back to the D string, and then back to 3rd position, and then back to half position. This is all outlined in the print off that you will see at the end of this video, so you can emulate the fingerings if you choose to. The most crucial thing to do, though, when you're playing this is as follows. So see, when I'm under tempo, it's slow in velocity, I'm making it nice and loose. Same thing there at 13. And then also in 15. So you will notice as you speed up with velocity, if you keep that as loose as possible, it's a lot easier to play faster. You do not want to stop your motion in between the notes because that creates stiffness. And we all know that what happens to a helicopter blade when it gets faster, it starts droopy, then it gets stiff. You don't want to start stiff. So make sure that you keep relaxed. For those of you that have big hands, by all means, do the pivoting back and do the extensions to avoid the shifts. If it's easy for you to do it that way, I would encourage that. For the rest of us, I would assume that this might be a better fingering. For you that take private lessons, your teachers may have a whole other formula of different positioning. Go with that. The key, though, is to keep your hands relaxed. Some other technique tricks that we want to be thinking about when we play this is I actually start the piece with an up bow because I find it a lot easier to do that and come over to the down bow on the open A. And then also what's great is that you land on all the focal points with the music on down bows, like for instance, between 5 and 6, where we want to crescendo, and where we don't have to have a lot of sound, it's great to start with an up. That also with the length of bow is an important trick. Make sure that when you're thinking on the C string, you're pushing into the string and keeping it what I call pizzicato, really, really short. And then as you go over to the A string, you think of what the A string needs, and that's a little bit more length. And then as you go down, it gets shorter. So think about that when you're going through those series of descending lines. And then of course, when you get to the C string and you're having those crescendos, more sound, more bow, that's really important. But the most important thing is to learn to decrescendo and use subito pianos where you can. Really short pizzicato sound. What else do I want to tell you about this piece? Let's see. Oh, how to practice it. When you're practicing, don't try to practice the whole thing. If you learn how to run, you don't learn to run by running a marathon first. We take it 1 5K at a time. So only take maybe 2 measures at a time and work getting the framework of what fingering you like, and then start your metronome on a slow tempo bass. I still do quarter, but I may go down to say like, oh, I don't know, maybe like 80. And let me show you an example of that. So I'm gonna start at the beginning and I'm gonna start at metronome 80. Hopefully you can hear that. So I'm gonna work just those 2 measures and work for evenness, trying to make sure I'm even, because string crossings can cause a lot of inconsistency when it comes to space between notes, okay? So you work that, and you work it all the way up to as fast as you can make it, you know, maybe around 100. And then you connect 2 more measures, work 2 more measures up to that, and then put them together and build like that. But don't try to do the whole piece in one shot. You'll kill yourself with that. So make sure it's just one chunk at a time. When you get across a gnarly bit that you can't seem to do, actually work it at the tempo that you want, like around 100, but just add a note at a time. I call this the layer effect. So for instance, say I'm at 100, and I'm playing measure 11, and I get stumbled up like here. And I can't do that. So what I'm gonna do instead is I'm gonna take it down maybe 1 or 2 notches, add a note at a time. Then I add the next one. And then I add the next one. And then you'll have more success with those kind of difficult passages that are hard to get into a comparable speed. Then also work in reverse. Start at a healthy tempo and then go slower and slower. You'll learn where you tend to rush, where you tend to go too slow. And playing in between notes is where our challenge is. It's the gap. It's not the note itself. And the trajectory we have to be even when we play on all these different variables this way and this way. A couple other technical things for the bow. Work on making sure that you really inflect with the grasp and release of your fingers to get that pizzicato sound, all right? Also, don't make your arm do all the work when it comes to string crossings. Really use your swivel or your torso. Meet the string to the right, and then meet the string to the left. Work your upper body to help you facilitate getting there quicker. That will help a lot. And then a slow layer effect and looping effect with the metronome will really help that a lot. I would say it's important to be effective with practice with the metronome constantly, and don't go past your comfort zone. It's better to practice and reinforce it correctly than incorrectly. That's it for this one. Best of luck. Okay, here we are with our second excerpt. This is the Mahler Symphony No. 1 Long Psalm. Long Psalm meaning slow, but it doesn't seem like it's slow when you play this piece with the tempo marking indicator. Long Psalm means slow, and then this is supposed to be depicting a summer's day with the awakening of nature, but with the little busy bees and birds. You'll hear a little cuckoo effect there in measure 18 and 19, which is kind of fun. Advice for this, one of the challenges we have is tenor clef. Quick tutorial on tenor clef. Anything below the top ledger line, just read a string over or a fifth higher. The other two indicators for anything above the top ledger line is to make sure that this top ledger line is E harmonic, and then A harmonic is D in bass clef, so that will help you. Then just think stepwise motion to read it from that point on. Forward in the musical alphabet means up in pitch, backwards in the musical alphabet means down in pitch, or backwards on the instrument. Also with this one, important to use the metronome. I like the marking of actually doubling it at 160. Obviously, when you practice it, practice under that after you get the framework. But it's really important to keep consistent because we have big rhythmic jumps between half notes and eighth notes, and we want to make sure that we're consistent all the way through. One of the things I do is when I start off the piece is I start mid-bow. So I have plenty of bow for that. Then when I get to here in measure 3, which is very similar to the second selection, measure 16, you count that 4, 2, 3, 4, retake, articulate at the balance point, makes it nice and short and crisp. Moving on from that point, some of the big shifts that we have in the upper range, when you look at measure 8, you're having to go, getting up to that D, you want to work on placement between the G sharp, so that tritone sound, to get that pitch in your mind, okay? The scale up after that, work on hearing the main notes of the scale, like D, E, F sharp, G sharp, A, B, and then on the way down as well. Notice I use the fingerings that I have in the music as well. So that way you hear the spine of that line and then you could put it together. And so forth and so on. Now, on to selection 3. Some very similar things that happen at the beginning, like selection 2. You start mid-bow, you kind of do a retake and re-articulate at 17. The famous cuckoo line at 18, what I want you to think of is how are you practicing that shift? So one of the things you could do is work on shifting from D to A harmonic a lot. So your arm gets that memorized and then you place, there you go. Two options for that, you could practice or play it, placing the 1 and then the 2, or sweep with the 2. That same interval is in measure 21 as well, so treat it the same way. Practice it from the C sharp up to the A harmonic and then place the 2. And then again, you can always tuck when you play it as well. This next scale is very similar to the one that you had at 10. You want to make sure that you play the main notes. I start a D scale halfway through 23. Just hit the main note 1, A, B, C sharp, D, okay? And then you could put the chromatic notes in between. Sometimes we get a little lost. We tend to get sharp or we tend to get flat when we do chromatic. So hearing those main notes first will help you hear it better. At the last part of the piece, I would suggest there's several fingerings. I put a couple options in the music you could take a look at. If you have big hands, go for it with how you want to finger it. I like to finger it in thumb and go across the string and then come back, shift to 1 on F sharp, and then go across for the D harmonic. For those of you that have big hands, you can always try something along the lines of up the A string, sweep through with the three, and then also when you come to this part, lean towards the four, pivot back for the D. So that's another option. So I've left plenty of options there at the ending of fingerings that you can try. Best of luck. We're at the third excerpt with the Scheherazade by Rimsky-Korsakov. This is a real treat for cellists. This whole piece is beautiful. If you have the chance to listen to the tone poem, you should. It's rich, it's sonorous, and we're very privileged to be able to get one of the wonderful melody lines from this great work. So why did they give us this excerpt? Well, treble clef, or as cellists like to call it, treble clef. We aren't used to doing that. We're used to doing tenor. But it's really not that difficult to read once you get the hang of it. If you think of the bottom staff line, that is the start of E. Most of the time, the pieces that are in treble clef are gonna start from that point up. That's the point, to not have a lot of ledger lines to read. But so when you wanna have an indicator to help you, or signpost to help you learn how to read treble clef, this is where you start. You start from that E. And in this piece, I think we only go as high as B above the A harmonic and as low as B on the A string. So you just have an octave in which to work this through. So for instance, the first part, you are on an F sharp because that's the space above the bottom line E. And then you play G sharp, or G natural, excuse me. Notice the fingerings that I have written in the music are more lyrical fingerings, so they're not what you would typically do at the beginning. You might try three and four if it's easier for you. Then the second space from the bottom, that's A harmonic. So we know to go to a one there, and then the B is the last note. That's the highest note right after that. Then from there, anything that's below this line, for instance, if you look at measure five, you have E, F sharp, E, then you go below it to D, C sharp, D. So again, just go up in pitch, down in pitch, and down in the music and up in and stepwise, and you'll learn it more clearly. I don't know why Rimsky-Korsakov put it in treble clef. It makes more sense to be in tenor, but there you have it. So the other thing that I would suggest is put the fingerings in that you like. Be comfortable with when you're shifting. I've put some suggestions in. That's just so they're more lyrical, but you don't have to do that. One note that in the music that I want you to look at, though, is at measure 14, there's not a dot on the third note. So if you look at, we go over to the B, C sharp, it should be dot on the A and then reintroduction of that A. I don't know if it's a misprint, but just want you to know that. So re-pronunciate that when you do that. Also, in terms of practice, there's a lot to digest with this piece. You have different clefs, you have complicated rhythms, you have complicated bowings and shifts. So do what I call the three prongs of practice: notes, rhythm, and bowing. Take a phrase, just do notes evenly. To decide what you like in terms of fingerings and to know the language of the notes. Then put in the rhythm. Sometimes I subdivide the 16ths when I have a dotted eight, and I subdivide the dotted quarter notes into eighths, something like this. That helps me know the length. You could also use the metronome, triple the tempo indicator to be three times that. I think it's 138 is the max. Instead of using a dotted quarter beat, use the eighth note beat and practice diligently with a metronome on it because it'll keep you honest. So use that, obviously start at a slower tempo, but that'll help you know the differences between the dotted rhythms and the tied rhythms and so on. And then also exaggerating between when you have a dotted rhythm and a regular straight rhythm. That's really important as well. So, like I said, three prongs of practice, notes, rhythm, and then bowing. And then you should be set. Well, I hope this was helpful today. Again, my name is Erin Renier, and I am the professor of cello here at Washburn University. You will see below my contact information. Feel free to reach out if you have any questions. I'd be more than happy to do a Zoom lesson, or if I'm in your neighborhood, I can come and take a lesson with you at one of your schools. I'm here to help. I know it's a struggle sometimes, especially for those you students that don't take private lessons and don't have help. We want to be able to help you because we want to see you have success. So please take whatever advice I've given you today and hopefully work it and feel encouraged that we all want to make beautiful music and we're all here to help each other. Have a great day.